Thank you all very much. Good morning, and thank you so much for being a part of today's event. I'm so excited to be here in person and to feel some real life energy for a change. So I'm really excited and grateful for each and every one of you for being here. As you've heard, my name is Garrett McQueen, and I'm very excited to be before you today to offer a few words on my work and to offer a few insights on today's theme of engaging and building community. As you heard in my introduction, I wear many hats in the field of music and even in the general ecosystem. I consider myself a musician, first and foremost. I'm a producer. I work as an activist. I offer lectures and keynotes like this one, and I strive to inspire in people's minds the thoughts that will turn into the actions that will eventually change the arts field and the entire world. It's important to understand and internalize the fact that this isn't easy work or overnight work that we're all trying to engage and to participate in. If there's anything I want you to take away from my presentation today, it's the fact that generations upon generations of work have gone into creating and maintaining the ecosystem we're all trying to navigate and change today. At the same time, it'll take at least that long, at least a generation, before we see something different and before we're experiencing different things in these spaces. This isn't my way of diminishing the urgency of the work that we have to do, because it is very urgent work, but rather it's my way of just reminding us all of the responsibility that we have and our place on the timeline and in the world to do what we can, where we can. The late, great James Baldwin wrote that not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. I hope that as we continue to move through what has been, for many of us, the most challenging of times, we can have the courage to face the problems, the challenges that we have been afforded, understand how the solutions to those problems are unique to each of our experiences, and to act on them. A huge shout out and thank you to Rocky Diaz for inviting me here today, and a thank you once again to each and every one of you for being a part of this event. Before I continue, I'd like to acknowledge that this presentation is coming from the ancestral land of the Wapakuti Sioux, who are a smaller part of the broader Eastern Dakota. I not only acknowledge their ancestral rights to this land, but their contemporary rights to this land. As we continue to learn more about land acknowledgments and to do them, I think it's important to do more than just acknowledge for the sake of land acknowledgments not becoming another performative action we're seeing in our art spaces. So to that, I'd like to remind you briefly of what's going on with Line 3. Line 3, if you don't know, is a proposed pipeline expansion to bring nearly 1 million barrels of tar sands per day from Alberta, Canada to Superior, Wisconsin. It was proposed in 2014 by Enbridge, which is a Canadian pipeline company responsible for the largest inland oil spill in the so-called United States. Enbridge seeks to build a new pipeline corridor through untouched wetlands and the treaty territory of Anishinaabe peoples through the Mississippi River headwaters to the shore of Lake Superior. So for the sake of the land and out of respect for the people whose land this is, I encourage everyone to learn more and to do what you can by visiting stopline3.org. So, as a people, we're facing a problem, many problems, but what are those problems or those challenges? What is the challenge that we face when it comes to building and engaging communities, especially in our spaces? It's definitely a multi-pronged issue with multi-pronged solutions, but all in all, I see most of it as being circumstantial. We can't help many of the issues that we've inherited. For the vast majority of us, COVID flipped our worlds upside down. Simple things like being with one another in person, working with one another in person, teaching in the ways that we're used to teaching, and navigating the world in general have been thrown into the proverbial pressure cooker. Our worlds have changed, and this has put a strain on all of us. And when you couple those strains with police brutality, the murders of members of our society, a widening socioeconomic gap, and even vaccine hesitancy, we're left with a world that I would say is more splintered than we've ever experienced, certainly more splintered than I've ever experienced. I've been watching different specials and documentaries as we approach the 20-year anniversary of the attacks on 9/11, and a lot of people are making a point that I'd never really thought about, but one that's important to consider, I think. It's the fact that those attacks resulted in newfound solidarity when they occurred 20 years ago. In the city of New York especially, but across the country, people were helping one another all of a sudden, engaging each other across different communities, and putting the concept of being an American into action. Now let me be clear. I'm not here to try and drum up any sort of patriotism out of anyone, artificial or otherwise. I only mean to compare the tragedies of 2001 to the challenges of today. Think about it. Over the past year and a half, we haven't come closer together, but rather we've grown farther apart, even physically so. When you think about the idea of social distancing, we've been further apart in ways that we've never been. From behind our masks that I believe we should all still be wearing, for the record, we've lost the art of the friendly smile or the nod of acknowledgement as we pass each other by. This cultural separation has taken hold not only at the individual level, but at the community level. And if we don't actively consider these ideas and these truths, I think we risk never being able to come back to the people we once were, or even the people we hope to be. What I see as our solution, at least one solution, is to engage the narratives and to engage the experiences that drive the communities that we wish to engage, and even the communities that we've never engaged in our work. When I think about this idea of engaging communities, I think about the creation of race records during the early 20th century. It was a phenomenon that lumped the artistic work and musical recordings of black musicians into a category that was separated from all other music. This didn't kill or hurt black music, of course. It simply made way for its evolution and for its growth to occur apart from other music communities and broader communities. And what an evolution that was, after all. The world's preeminent genres of music, hip-hop, gospel, jazz, and all of the iterations of that original black music that was marginalized and pushed to the side, serve as the foundations of some of the strongest and most influential systems the world has ever seen. Systems that many of us, folks like you and me, operate outside of, thanks in part to the cultural and musical segregation of decades past. When we step a little further away from this picture of just specifically music, we have to consider the very same thing when it comes to cultural narratives and experiences. What are the conversations that are evolving in the spaces that musical professionals like ourselves haven't gained access to? How can our experiences inform the experiences of others, communities that we haven't always engaged with, and vice versa? What's our path toward facing each other, facing those problems, as James Baldwin said, and seeing that we have more in common than not? My answers to these questions revolve around narrative affirmation, hearing each other, and understanding each other to the best of our ability with empathy and beyond what we see on the surface. My goal today is to demonstrate this, to show you examples of how engaging and applying marginalized narratives have served as my entry point into new communities, engaging new communities, and how rapport building has been key in my work of building with and actively engaging those communities that we haven't always. So in the spirit of narrative affirmation and building rapport, I wanted to take a little time to outline my own story, to share with you who I am beyond the work specifically, and to give you a look at my own development and how I got here. To do this, I have to take y'all to church, if you don't mind. For generations, communities of Black folk down south, where I'm from, have treated the church as a meeting place, and not just as a meeting place for praise and worship. The church has played an integral role in civil rights, in education, and in general community building since folks that look like me were given our alleged freedom after the Civil War. And it served as my foundation to many, many things. When I consider some of my earliest experiences as a little church boy, I think about how that community molded me in many different ways. Standing at the pulpit and reading scriptures helped me get a footing with public speaking, for example, early practice. Spending my Saturdays handing out food or handing out school supplies to the neighborhoods that surrounded the church taught me that the world is bigger than my own needs and my own wants alone. And of course, learning to read music, learning the difference between a melody and a harmony, how to improvise, and all of those other bits of oral training in church directly connect to my love of music then and now. It's community that gave me all of those things. So by the time I hit middle school, I was about 12 years old, I considered myself a little too good of a singer to join the school choir, thanks to that community training. So I decided to join the band and to learn how to play an instrument. Back in those days, the band director basically picked the instrument that you would learn to play for you, at least where I grew up, and that's how I met the bassoon. I had no idea what it was or even how to put the thing together, but I was excited to try something new, so I went for it and I dove in head first. I'll never forget coming home with that bassoon for the very first time as a 12-year-old. I did manage to get it put together and to make a few sounds for my parents. And as I was doing so, my mother just kind of shook her head, wondering what she'd gotten herself into by agreeing to let me join the band. My dad, on the other hand, figured that this could be my gateway to college, so he ended up tolerating my at-home practice a little better than my mom did, I'll say. As I continued to traverse my middle school and high school career as a bassoonist, I slowly began to feel a separation from those communities that gave me my love for music. It wasn't the spirituals of Moses Hogan and Henry Burleigh that I was learning to play and to perfect in my school music program. It was the music of European men who I'd never heard of that became central to my training. This proved to be a challenge because my church and family communities didn't know how to engage those sounds or those ideas or those aesthetics. And honestly, how could they? Sure, there were other instrumentalists in my periphery, some even in my family, but none of them could teach me how to trill from above the notes, for example, or how to prepare an orchestral excerpt for an audition. So much of my learning happened in isolation. I spent hours in my room reading about music, listening to music, and evolving away from community, just like those race records I spoke to. Well, despite those challenges, the hard work paid off because, as my dad had hoped, I got a scholarship to college and I was soon to become a first-generation college graduate. But how different would my trajectory have been if I had a community of people surrounding me and guiding my path along the way? Who knows where I would have ended up? As a college student, my love for the bassoon really exploded, and thankfully, I managed to find community among my student colleagues. You have to remember, as a kid, I never met other bassoonists, so having folks to engage with in this way played a big role in my sticking with music. I was even lucky enough to study with a teacher who looked like me and who could speak to my experiences. What I didn't know then was that this was particularly rare, especially in Western classical music. Well, after graduating, my teacher, Lacoli in Washington, pushed me toward the West Coast, where I would earn a master's degree in bassoon performance from the University of Southern California. It's there where I studied with Judy Farmer. Now, by this time, the communities that I was engaging in looked completely different than those church gatherings that formed my love for music. I was always the only black person in studio class or the only black person on stage, and oftentimes even the only black guy in the audience when I would go to attend shows, and honestly, this started to weigh on me. I didn't feel like my story could really be understood by the people who surrounded me, but I pressed on. And when I left graduate school, I earned a temporary contract with the Detroit Symphony Orchestra. This was a really challenging time because, as a fellow, I wasn't treated as a full member of the orchestra. I didn't feel that community, but I knew that I had to stick with it. I felt like I had a responsibility to all of the communities of people who helped guide my path. So before ending my time with the DSO, I worked really hard and was lucky enough to win a permanent position with the Knoxville Symphony Orchestra back in my home state of Tennessee, and I felt like I had really made it. The communities of musicians that I basically treated as family over the course of my education saw that it was actually possible to be part of an orchestra professionally, and I really took pride in that. But I was still never able to shake the fact that I didn't see members of the communities that I first engaged in my work, not on stage, not in the crowd, and not even on the concert programs. This is when I decided to take some action. 3 years into my tenure as second bassoon with the Knoxville Symphony Orchestra, I went out for a temporary position at the local radio station, WUOT-FM. I knew that if I could convince a community of public radio listeners that classical music is more than what's being presented to them, I had a chance at seeing more folks like me in the spaces that I inhabited, creating community. My approach to programming on the radio was not only to include, but to center the music of black composers, BIPOC composers, and composers who are women. There was some resistance at first. People aren't always used to change, certainly not public radio listeners, but I kept pressing on, and the approach eventually paid off. The community of listeners that I was engaging each and every afternoon down in Knoxville were so engaged by what I was offering that I was given the radio job permanently. Something that was meant to be a short stint, a little side project, ended up being a complete career shift for me. As I continued in my advocacy for more diverse music over the airwaves, communities of change makers started to reach out to me. They saw the work that I was doing. Remember, I spoke to my early church days not only as the foundation of my love for music, but as the foundation of my ability to speak to communities of people. Well, those communities of change makers offered me platforms that would eventually land me a spot on the national airwaves here in Minnesota. As my determination and as my audience grew, so did my sense of community. I knew that what I was doing had real impact, and I trusted, based on that impact, that if my activism resulted in another career shift, I would have a soft landing thanks to my many, many supporters and the communities that engage my work. As most folks know about me, thanks to a number of news headlines and internet posts, my activism as a music programmer and presenter did indeed result in a career change for me, a year ago today, as a matter of fact. And while the road has been challenging, I wouldn't change a single thing. Why is that? Community. I owe everything to the community of people who gave me the gifts of speech and the gifts of music at an early age. I would be letting down the communities of musicians I met in college by taking my hand off the proverbial plow. Even the community of activists and change makers, supporters of my work that I engage today, continue to help push me along. It's community that's at the center of just about everything I do. So now that you have the basic gist of who I am and maybe how I am, I want to go through a few examples of how I try to center community and rapport building through my work of engaging and affirming community narratives. Hopefully my experiences can inspire you to think about how you can do the same in your work as musicians, teachers, and advocates. The most common narrative that I come across in many of the communities that I engage is one that I imagine many of you have heard before. Classical music is for white people. First and foremost, why does this narrative exist in the first place? Well, look around you. How many people of color have played a role in your love for Western classical music? I was lucky enough to have a black teacher at the beginning of my journey, as I spoke to earlier. But as I mentioned, when I was laying out my own story, this was rare. It's something that I didn't realize was rare until I really got into the field. Because classical communities have maintained a cultural and musical divide from the rest of the world over the ages, a self-imposed segregation, it's hard to argue that black folk and other people of color should feel comfortable in an orchestra hall or in an opera house. Well, through my experiences, I'm able to affirm those truths, but to also show those people who are doubtful of those spaces, even spaces like these, that there is change happening. There is movement. The biggest way I engage this narrative specifically is by introducing to people the idea of a decolonized definition of classical music. When we think about the music of the world, the classical traditions of India, the classical traditions of East Asia, South America, and especially the motherland, and everywhere else, we have lots of classical music, just not the sort of classical music as defined by Western Europe. To this point, I try to help communities that carry that classical music is white narrative. I try to help them to understand that the classical tradition in America really is rooted in folks that look like me. With the exception of music codified by indigenous populations, there's nothing more purely American than the Negro spiritual. Think about it. During the transatlantic slave trade, people who were not from the African continent brought all sorts of things over to the New World: clothing, food, disease, but also musical traditions and ideas behind music. Conversely, black folk, all they had was themselves, and really not even that when you really consider the nature of the slave trade. But despite all odds, those early Afro-Americans built not only community, but this entire country, with one of the means of communication being the Negro spiritual. This wasn't something that came from anywhere else. The spiritual wasn't imported from Africa or any other part of the world. It grew right here from that very soil that black folks worked for generations, and that makes it uniquely and purely American. Even the great European composer Antonin Dvorak recognized this. When he visited the United States in the late 19th century, he was famously quoted as saying, "In the Negro melodies of America, I find all that is needed for a great and noble school of music." Now consider that idea for a second, that quote, that idea that Dvorak had. It wasn't the transplanting of European orchestral music that he saw as fundamentally American or the future, but rather the sounds that were created and born here. In our attempts to engage communities that hold tight to that classical music is white narrative, as so-called classical music professionals, practitioners of European classical music, we owe it to ourselves and to those communities to make sure that we're observing history in this way, and not only observing this history, but actually applying this history to our work. So what does this mean? Well, for me, it means that as I continue to work in the field of radio as a freelance producer, I have an obligation to challenge the status quo and affirm the communities that are affirmed by a renewed definition of American classical music. The idea of classical being a term that applies to American culture in the same way we apply it to other world cultures. Now, understand that this is still a radical idea for a lot of people, a complete reframing of the phrase classical music, but I see it as a primary way in which communities of color can be engaged by our work, again, affirming the black music and all of its iterations as American classical. I'd like to share with you an example of how I'm doing this in real time. With the magic of radio and the internet and everything else, I've actually been guest hosting the morning show in St. Louis this week, and I'm going to be doing it next week. And I'm applying this concept, American classical music, black music being American classical music, to the way I program. So I'm going to share a couple of radio moments with you. This is what folks are going to be hearing in St. Louis on Monday. It's getting to be that time of year when you can feel a slight chill in the mornings, at least if you wake up early enough, right? The season of orange and red leaves and pumpkin spice things is coming up just around the corner. There's lots of music that celebrates the changing of seasons, including this one. It's even named after an autumn month. The composer definitely had autumn in mind when he wrote it, but there's even more to this piece of music than just cooler temperatures and changing leaves. I'll tell you a little bit more about it in about 5 minutes. I have to say, though, when I think about this time of year, impending autumn, I can't help but to think back to high school football season when the band would play those classic tunes like September. Do you remember? That's even the opening question of the tune, right? Do you remember September by Earth, Wind, and Fire? So I would definitely say that there are communities of people affirmed by hearing that on classical radio. I have another example for you as well. Her name was Georgia O'Keeffe, the woman known by many as the mother of American modernism. In addition to painting things like skylines and landscapes and really big flowers, the late Miss O'Keeffe inspired artists of many different disciplines, even music. The work you just heard was actually inspired by a painting of Georgia O'Keeffe. A composer from Michigan named Eleanor Ruhr found herself in a museum in Chicago, and after staring at the O'Keeffe paintings for a while, she decided to create a collection of musical works that would reframe O'Keeffe's creations. Get it? Reframe? Eleanor Ruhr called that collection of musical compositions O'Keeffe Images. You just heard the selection subtitled Sky Above Clouds that was brought to you this morning by the Boston Modern Orchestra Project. Well, before I get into the last piece of music for this hour, I'd like to remind you that you can listen here to Classic 107.3 wherever you are. You can find us on TuneIn, you can find us at radio.com, or you can download our app. Just go into your device's app store and search Classic 107.3. Here's a little Drake to round out the hour as the summer season continues to wind down officially. It's from the B-side of his Scorpion album, a tune here that he called Summer Games. So if you would like to tune in, you just heard how you can do that. I'm affirming communities in the St. Louis area by matching what we think of when we use the phrase classical music with what I think more of us should be thinking about. I'm sure I'm going to get a lot of emails, but I'm expecting more good than not. It's all about having the courage to push forward and really break the mold in whatever way we can. So, thank you. So I think teachers and other music advocates can do the same thing by making sure that the music you use to develop your students speaks to these truths and this history. Do your students understand the significance of the Negro spiritual? Can they name black composers and other black musicians? Is the definition of classical music you're imposing on them one that's rooted in American culture or one that's been derived from a Western European perspective? Important points that I think about as we all think about engaging this narrative in the communities that hold some of those ideas. So in my work, I've been lucky enough to get to engage communities of new music professionals. Like the phrase classical music, so-called classical music, as I say oftentimes, the phrase new music is also a little complicated. Just yesterday, I participated in a new music panel out of Chicago that challenges that idea, our definition of new music to an extent, still being rooted to that Western European perspective, which in itself create barriers between communities. I just wanted to make sure that I acknowledged that small point before I moved forward and kept using the phrase new music. So, with that being said, I found that so-called new music communities are among the more progressive among us oftentimes, communities of musicians who have turned their backs on censoring folks like Beethoven and Brahms for the sake of highlighting composers and music creators who are actually alive. Holding an appreciation for these ideas isn't quite enough to actually gain entry into new music communities, though, at least not in my case. It took a head-on approach to a narrative that I found is more common than not within those communities, the idea that classical music isn't separate from the world or a sort of escape from what's really going on out there from our day-to-day experiences, but a part of our lives. The way that I've engaged this narrative and the communities of musicians who hold it is by affirming not only the music, but the musician. So often in our training, we went to our weekly lessons or to rehearsals, leaving all of our baggage at the door. When I was in grad school, I wasn't even allowed to bring my bassoon case into the room. I had to be prepared before I entered the space. I don't think this is necessarily a bad thing, leaving your literal or proverbial baggage at the door, but what great music has come from a lack of personal experience or personal perspective? What would Beethoven's Fifth be if we didn't have the story of his impending deafness? Would the power behind Florence Price's single movement piano concerto be as intense if we didn't understand the hardships of a black woman composer in the 1930s and 1940s. Let's even fast forward to today. There's a work out there by living composer Adolphus Hailstork called A Knee on the Neck. Doesn't our collective experience of being here in the Twin Cities during the summer of 2020 impact our understanding of that title and even the music that it represents? We have to affirm and engage the whole person and all things musical, and I've done this through some of the visual content that I've had the pleasure of creating. In 2019, I was lucky enough to meet a man named Damien Strange at a racial equity summit hosted by the American Composers Forum. In his presentation, he spoke to the fact that his unique experiences as a human weren't always considered when taking on commissions and when writing new music, again, so-called new music. The pain of the present, much less the pain of the past, was forced into the background, which resulted in musical experiences that weren't always as genuine as they could be. I heard those words and took them to heart and decided to not only platform Damien's music, but his experiences as well. We recorded a really great conversation that covered lots of things, including his grandmother's work as a freedom fighter in Washington, D.C., the challenges he faced moving to Minnesota in the 90s to attend McAllister College, and the importance of places on conversations surrounding mental health and paying attention to one's body. Affirming the whole musician was foundational to my rapport building with Damien and also to meeting other musicians, including Devon Russell Gray and Sarah M. Greer, who are actually featured in the performance that I'm about to share with you. It's a work that Damien calls Dream Variations. Here's what I was lucky enough to capture.
A little bit more. It usually goes into another section, so this having that last note in the piano ring, Vibrate a little, yeah.
You got it.
Want to try it again? Let's do it.
So again, I have to stress my ability to capture that performance and to be able to engage with the musicians you saw in that video is rooted in rapport, seeing and engaging the human before trying to siphon off some sort of musical whatever we want to get from people. We have to take this idea into our education work. When your students come to see you, do you care if they're feeling a little down? Are you familiar with the physical, the mental, and emotional challenges that your students and their families face? Do they know that you care about their humanity as much, if not more, than their musicianship? As you continue to spread your love for music to your students, never forget the power behind human relationships. It just might be a conduit to your entrance to communities that you aren't yet able to engage in the most genuine way, especially when we talk about communities of people who don't center a hundreds-year-old view of what music is important and impactful. So if I've learned anything in my past year of work, it's that change makers in music come in all types. You have people who believe in step-by-step incremental change, and then you have people like myself who are a little less patient when it comes to equity and social progress in Western classical music. Talking the talk isn't enough to be able to actively and genuinely engage more radical change makers. So I've had to push my own activism into high gear as a means of gaining entry into some of those communities, doing so by affirming the narrative that radical change is a viable and real way forward. Before I get into my application and affirmation of this narrative as it parlays with my work today, I want to back up and speak again to my former job as a non-freelance radio producer. I worked overnight, so most days and all of my early evenings were spent in bed. I was never able to catch the evening news because I had to be coherent enough to talk about orchestral music all night long. Well, one Tuesday evening, I woke up at about 9:30 p.m. to get ready to head into work overnight when my partner walked up to me with a face full of fear before I could hop in the shower or do anything else. He stopped me and said, "Garrett, the third precinct is on fire." Naturally, I turned to the television and saw what we all saw, the intersection of Lake and Minnehaha filled with people surrounding a burning police station. Now, the protocol for emergencies when it came to my former job was to check for the "don't come into work, we'll go into automation" text message. So naturally, I went to my phone, but I didn't receive that text. And over the course of the uprisings, I never would. This is when I knew I had some real work to do. I couldn't stand aside and do nothing while the most radical of us went into action on the streets. I also knew that I couldn't risk catching COVID or getting arrested by joining my compatriots because a national radio platform is huge. So I did what I could and changed the programming night after night. My first thought when I heard that George Floyd had been murdered was thinking about his family, the cries from a mother or from a father mourning their son. The piece of music that started my summer of disobedience, as I call it, what I saw as radical action in the classical radio sphere, was by introducing a piece by a composer named Eric Whitaker. We're going to listen to about the first 90 seconds of it here. My son, even as I listen to that right now, I almost get choked up thinking about that night, thinking about what it would mean if I had to run for my life if the building caught on fire, thinking about traversing the military trucks that lined the streets, such an important time in our history that I knew I had to speak to in some way. And that's how I did it. That's how it all started. My first thought, again, when I heard that George Floyd had been murdered was his family, the cries from a mother, "my son." And we all have the ability to engage our communities through our knowledge of the repertoire. People are always asking me how exactly I went against programming protocol at NPR, so I thought I'd offer that example to you today. So no, I wasn't out in the streets, but I was doing what I could. And this got the attention of more activists than I can name, certainly more than I was able to respond to when the news of my termination spread across the country. The results were huge. By affirming disobedience, again, radical action, I was able to engage communities that I didn't even know existed, and there were lots of benefits to this. For one, my podcast, Triloquy, grew exponentially, and I've grown and maintained that audience, a community of listeners, for almost 3 years now. Not an easy thing to do as an independent content creator in a world of YouTube and TikTok. The growth of Triloquy eventually made way for the creation of Trilworks, which is the umbrella under which I create all of my content, including the local guest hosting content that I shared a bit with you, and a show called The Sound of 13, which is still in national syndication across public radio markets. My racial activism, radical activism even, also caught the attention of a group of change makers in opera, the Black Opera Alliance. And in joining them, I've had the privilege of engaging in one-on-one dialogues with executive directors and administrative professionals in the opera field, not only across the country, but around the entire world. I've even been able to be a part of non-musical activism communities, including the Brewing Change Collaborative here in the Twin Cities. They're a consortium of Black brewers fighting for change in that industry. I've even been a part of financial literacy movements, thanks to my activism, which I'll share a little bit of with you here. I had the pleasure of being a guest on a show called Finance and Affirmations, and I was able to spread my love and knowledge of music into a conversation that didn't necessarily center music.
With you going, you said that you went to school and things of that nature, and mm-hmm. So this is Finance and Affirmations.
Yeah.
And so one of the questions I typically ask my guest is, what was your initial financial education? That's the one that you got from your parents.
Yep.
And your family. So how did that show up for you early on, and how did you walk through that as you went to school and things like that?
Yeah. Well, I'll never forget. So as I'm, you know, again, in my early days of playing the bassoon, maybe I'm in, I don't know, eighth or ninth grade at this point, I want to be in the Memphis Youth Symphony, and they have a $20 application fee. And my mom did not feel right about sending $20 in the mail for something that, you know, from her perspective, excuse me, I may not end up sticking with or doing forever.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
Kids love to get into stuff,
right.
and maybe mm-hmm. they'll drop it. So that was kind of her perspective on it. So as early as that, even as it intersects with my musical life, just really hanging on to that dollar is something mm-hmm. that was always taught to me. You know, not only hanging. So we can use our experiences to engage communities of people who don't know anything about orchestral music or classical music. I've had the great pleasure of being able to do a lot of that work as well. So what does this mean to you? What is your version of visible or maybe even radical activism? I'm not saying that everyone needs to go out and burn something down necessarily, but I am saying that stepping outside of bounds, breaking the rules, coloring outside of the lines, so to speak, may be more beneficial than you think, especially when it comes to engaging communities of people who you haven't always. When I think about tangible examples of this in music teaching, I think of maybe assigning music that doesn't appear on the list of required repertoire. Maybe you can forego other rules for the sake of breaking down barriers and eliminating areas of gatekeeping. It's all about perspective at the end of the day, but never take for granted the ways in which community can be built by standing outside of what the rules say. So those are the ways in which I've been able to apply the idea of narrative affirmation toward building an engaging community. I still remember when I moved here, someone told me that the best way to meet someone is to have gone to kindergarten with them. That's sort of Minnesota nice, right? While I have experienced that bit of isolation in a way. I've also had the honor of being a part of so many communities here. Not all Minnesota outsiders get to boast that sort of thing. And I attribute just about all of it to the way I've affirmed the narratives that drive different communities. Before I offer some closing ideas, I wanted to leave a little room for questions or any discussion. And to get us started, I just thought I would break the ice by presenting a few questions here. What are the narratives that challenge you? How would you measure your awareness of marginalized ideas or narratives within music? Which communities do you engage with, and which communities do you feel a distance from? What are your barriers to new communities, and what are some specific benefits and specific results of engaging new communities through your work and from your perspective? Those are questions that I hope you'll take with you and continue to think about. But before I offer some closing ideas, are there any questions or any ideas or thoughts? Well, you can all Google me and send me your questions if you're if you're a little shy to speak in person. So I wanted to wrap up my time with you today with a clip that features one of my biggest musical influences, the late, great Nina Simone. As many people know, she was a groundbreaking musician and a groundbreaking activist. She's even one of the folks who's credited with codifying the phrase black classical music, as I do in so much of my work. But what a lot of people don't know about Miss Simone is that she built community by engaging a narrative, one that some might consider a little frightening, but one that others considered a lifeline, and history shows it. One of the reasons she's still one of the black community's patron saints is through her utter fearlessness. Let's take a listen to some of her words here.
If I had my way, I'd have been a killer, okay? That's true. I would have had guns, and I would have gone to the South and gave them violence for violence, shotgun for shotgun, if I had my way. But my husband told me I didn't know anything about guns, and he refused to teach me. And the only thing I had was music, so I obeyed him. But if I'd had my way, darn, I wouldn't be sitting here today. I'd be probably dead somewhere because I would have used guns during those years. I was never a nonviolent person.
Another quote of hers that I couldn't find the clip to, but that I really love. Apparently, there are stories when Nina Simone first met Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. She walked up to him, held out her hand, and said, "Dr. King, I am not unviolent." Now, I'm not proposing violence or anything like that, but I just have to make the point that as musicians, we are capable of so much, and we are capable of affirming so many people through our fearlessness, through our activism, and through the ways we engage communities, especially communities that we haven't always engaged. I can't say that I'd rather be a killer than a musician, but I can say that hearing those words from her have always pushed me to push as hard as I can. My weapon isn't a gun, it's my spoken word, something again that was nurtured from my original community of the black church, driven by my experiences in and love for music. Let's all do a better job of listening, of practicing empathy, and of affirming the narratives and the entire lives of more people so that we, in turn, can be affirmed by them. If you'd like to check out more of my work, be sure to visit my website, garrettmcqueen.com. You can find a link there also to my Trillworks media page, which will point you to some of the projects that I've created at the intersections of race, community, contemporary culture, and Western classical music. At the end of the day, it's all about freedom, but we can't get there unless we go there. And more importantly, we can't go there unless we go there together. So this is to freedom. Thank you so much for your attention and your time today.